In yesterday's class, we have understood the Miller notations for crystallographic planes in the cubic unit cell, and we have begun our discussion on Miller notations for hexagonal unit cell. The Miller notations for hexagonal unit cell is actually a four index notation represented by H, K, I, L. It is also called the Miller-Brewis lattices. If you use only three notation index system, which was HKL, it was called the Miller notations. And the four index notation, HKIL, is called the Miller-Brewis notation. So generally for hexagonal unit cell, we will going to use the four index notation or Miller's Brewis notation. At a later stage, I will explain to you how you can convert from Miller Brewis notation to the Miller notation and vice versa. So, in the last class, we were discussing this particular example where a plane which is shaded in blue color in the hexagonal unit cell is shown, and the problem was to identify the HKIL notation or say Miller-Brewis notation for this particular given plane. So whenever there is a hexagonal unit cell, you have to first define four corresponding axes. The four corresponding axes, amongst them, three of the ones lies in the basal plane. The basal plane I have shown separately on the left hand image, where you can see three axes marked as A1, A2 and A3. They are at 120 degrees apart from each other. And you can choose any of these three as A1, A2 and A3. The only rule which you have to follow is you have to either define them as clockwise or anticlockwise. Whichever way you want to do it, you should define it like that. The origin of the unit cell will be always the center of the lower basal plane, unless your plane is the one which is passing through the lower basal plane, center of the lower basal plane. Only in that case you will shift the origin to some other corner. Otherwise, for all other purposes, we always choose our origin to be the center of the lower basal plane. So this is our origin, which I have just marked. And with reference to that, I have three axes, A1, A2, and A3. I can also mark those three axes here in the same unit cell. So this is our A1. This is A2, and this one is A3. If you expand this axis in the opposite direction, you will get the corresponding negative ones. For example, if I extend this A1 in the opposite direction, here it will be minus A1. Likewise, this will be minus A2, and this will be minus A3. Right? And your fourth axis is the vertical axis, which we used to typically define as C. It represents the fourth coordinate of the Miller-Brewis notation, which is L coordinate. And that particular axis is here. So this is your fourth axis. So we have total four axes. Three of them lies in the basal plane, namely A1, A2, A3. They corresponds to index H, K, and I. And the fourth axis, which is the vertical axis, represents the fourth index, which is L. Remember, in Miller-Brewis notation, the value of I is always equal to the negative sum of H plus K. It has to follow this mathematical equality. then only you can have a correct Miller-Bravais notation. If any index plane is such that your I is not equal to negative sum of h plus k, you cannot define the Miller-Bravais notation. Means such Miller-Bravais notation does not exist. There is something wrong in the question itself. Okay? So always verify before attempting any problem in the Miller-Bravais notation, which is I to be equal to negative sum of h plus k. Now here is a query. The query states that can we have our origin on the upper basal plane? Answer is yes. You have to shift your basal plane to upper basal plane if your plane under interest lies on the lower basal plane and covers the center of the basal plane. Because the rule is your origin cannot lie on the plane. So if there is a situation where your plane is the horizontal plane lying in the basal plane, then you have to shift your origin to the other opposite vertical basal plane. Okay, so this example was clear. What we did is we draw this particular base of the plane here on the horizontal diagram and identify its intercept with the three basal axes. So it intersects the A1 axis at 1. It also intersects the A2 axis at 1. So your H and K intercepts are 1 and 1. And it intersects the A3 axis in the opposite direction at minus half. So your third intercept was minus half. And the plane under interest is running parallel to the vertical axis because your plane is a vertical plane. Remember, whenever the plane under interest is a vertical plane, your L index is always infinite. Your intercept on L is always infinite. Why? Because vertical plane is always parallel to the L axis. Once you know the intercepts, you have to take the reciprocals and put them into the parenthesis. So the reciprocal of 1, 1, minus 1 half infinity is 1, 1, bar 2, 0. And this is the Miller-Bravais notation for the plane that is shown in the unit cell. You can now cross-check the value of I, which is in this case minus 2, is actually the negative sum of h and k, which is 1 and 1. So if I add h and k, 1 plus 1 to be equal to 2, and I need to have a negative sign, so 1 plus 1 with a negative sign equal to minus 2, which is precisely the value of I. So you can cross-check whether you got the correct interpretation or not. Okay, let's move ahead to another example. Look at this particular case. Here, a unit cell is being shown and the plane under interest, which is showed as blue color shade, lies on one of the face of the hexagonal unit cell. So what will be the approach? Our approach will be identical. First, we take the basal plane out and define the origin and three mutual axes. Let me show you the origin again on the diagram itself. So here is my origin and corresponding axes are marked. The base of the plane under interest is here let me show that. The base is here. So I draw an identical line on the basal plane, which is the blue color line. And now you have to find out the intercept of this blue line on A1, A2, and A3. So what you can see easily is the blue color line intercepts the A2 at 1. It intercepts the A3. I can show you the A3 line. The A3 line is here. So it intersects the A3 at minus 1. The interesting question is, what happens to this blue line vis-a-vis to the A1 axis? So where is the A1 axis? Your A1 axis, I am marking it with another color. This was our A1 axis. And now you can tell me, what is the intercept of the yellow line with the blue line? They are running parallel to each other. That means our plane does not intersect with the A1 axis, rather than it is running parallel to it. So our intercepts are vis-a-vis to the A1 axis, since it is running parallel, so infinity. With A2 axis, it intersects at plus 1. With A3 axis, it intersects at minus 1. So these are the three basal axes. And now the fourth one. Fourth one is always easy. Just you have to ask yourself whether the plane under interest is a vertical plane. If your answer is yes, it will always run parallel to the C axis, which you can see here in the unit cell. So your plane and the yellow line are parallel to each other. So intercept along L is at infinity. And then you have to take the corresponding reciprocals. So reciprocal of infinity will be 0. Reciprocal of 1 will be 1, reciprocal of minus 1 will be bar 1, and reciprocal of infinity will be 0. So your Miller-Bravais notation for the plane under interest is 0, 1, 1 bar, 0. Now, you can always go from Miller-Bravais notation to the Miller notation. What is the difference? The Miller-Bravais notation is four index notation, namely H, K, I, L. And Miller notation is the three index notation, namely H, K, L. So if you want to go from Miller-Bravais to Miller, you have to eliminate the I notation. So you will not write the I value in the Miller-Bravais notation, then you will get the corresponding Miller notations. So if I write the Miller notation for the same plane, H is 0, K is 1, I am eliminating, so bar 1 I am not writing, and my L is 0. So my Miller notation for the blue shaded plane will be 0, 1, 0. Remember, when you use the Miller notation for the hexagonal unit cell, your I is hidden. Why your I is hidden? Because if I know H and K, indirectly I am knowing the value of I. So you can always go from Miller to Miller-Bravais, or from Miller-Bravais back to the Miller notation. Is it clear? Okay, I guess it is clear to everyone. Now, let us focus on another plane, which I am marking here on the same unit cell. We are interested in defining the plane, which I am just drawing now. We are interested not on this. We are interested in this particular plane, which I am marking in green color. So our interest is now in this particular face plane. This plane is now of our interest. So we want to find out the Miller-Bravais notation for another face plane. Process will be identical. You have to take the basal plane out and then find out the intercept of the base with A1, A2, A3 axis. So now I focus on this green color line on the basal plane, where my cursor is there at this point. Find out the intercept of this green color line on A1, A2, A3. So it's easy. Vis-a-vis to A1, the intercept is +1. Vis-a-vis to A2, it intersect at -1. Vis-a-vis to A3, you can see vis-a-vis to A3, the green color line runs parallel. So it is infinity. And the last one, you have to ask yourself whether the plane under interest is the vertical plane. Answer is yes. So the fourth index is also infinity. Now you take the reciprocals. So the reciprocal of 1 will be 1 bar 1. Infinity, infinity will give me 0, 0. So your Miller-Bravais notation for the green shaded plane is 1. 1 bar, 0, 0. And if you eliminate the value of I, you can write the corresponding notation in Miller, which is 1, 1 bar, 0. Remember, the last 0 represents the L value and not the I value. Okay, let's proceed further. We have another example. Let me clear the old drawing. Okay, now you have another plane which is shown as the blue color shade. We did the same example previously and we know its intercept with A1 was at +1, with A2 it was +1, and vis-a-vis to A3 it was -0.5. And the plane was the vertical plane. So okay, I'm going back because there is a query from Rajiv. He has some issue with the Miller notation for blue plane. Okay, let me go back and show you that. The blue plane is this one, whose Miller-Bravais notation is 0, 1, 1 bar, 0. Have you got that? The Miller-Bravais notation for the blue color plane? Okay. Now, I want to convert from Miller-Bravais to Miller. So, what I have to do is, I will simply not write the value of I. In Miller-Bravais, the first one is H. So I will write H as it is. Second one is K. I will write the value of K as it is in the Miller. Third one is I. So I will not write the value of I in the Miller. So I am not writing bar 1. And the fourth one, L, will go as such. Okay, so let's carry on. What we were defining was the Miller-Bravais notation for the given plane, the one which is shown in the blue color in the unit cell. We have previously attempted this problem, so I am attempting it once again because I want to show something else. So if I look at the blue line on the basal plane, it intersects A1 axis at plus 1, A2 axis at plus 1, and negative A3 at half. So my intercepts are 1, 1, minus 1 half, and since the plane is a vertical plane, so intersect will be at infinity. And then my reciprocals are 1, 1, minus half will give me bar 2, and infinity will give me 0. So the Miller-Bravais notation is 1, 1, 2 bar, 0. And if I eliminate bar 2, I am having the Miller notation, which is 1, 1, 0, which is not mentioned here. Now, look at the green color line, which is shown on the central image. What you can see is the green color line actually lies in the extended region of the lower basal plane, or you can say it lies outside the lower basal plane. Whenever you have a situation like this, you have to extend the magnitude of the unit cell. So if you carefully look at the green color line, what you can see is its intercept with A1 axis is at 1, but it intersects with the A2 axis at 2 unit difference. Where is the 2 unit? Let me show that. The first unit distance is here, and the another second unit distance is this. So vis-a-vis to A2 axis, it intersects with the A2 axis at 2 unit distance, and that too on the opposite side. So the intercept will be minus 2. Similarly, vis-a-vis to the A3 axis, if I want to find out the intercept of the green line with the A3 axis, then what I have to do is I have to extend this green line, which I am extending in the yellow color. So I am extending it. And now I have to also extend the A3 axis, which I am extending in the red color. And now you can see their intersection point. Their intersection point is also at 2 distance away on negative A3 side. So the intercept of the green line, which is actually lying outside the basal plane of the unit cell, has its intersection with A1, A2, and A3 as it intersects with A1 at plus 1, with A2 at minus 2, and with A3 also minus 2. Now, if I create a plane whose base is this green color line and the plane is vertically up, then my fourth index is the negative infinity, is the infinity. And if I take their reciprocals, it becomes the reciprocal of 1 will be 1. Reciprocal of minus 2 will be minus half. The reciprocal of minus 2 will be again minus half, and reciprocal of infinity will be 0. So what you have is a fractional number. Both minus 2 minus 2 gives you minus half minus half. And you cannot have your Miller-Bravais notation to be a fractional number. So what you have to do is, you have to take the LCM and multiply every number with the LCM. So your first index, which was 1, when multiplied by 2 becomes 2. Your second index, which was minus 1 half, when multiplied by 2 becomes minus 1. The third one, which was also minus 1 half, now becomes minus 1. And the fourth one is 0, so it will remain 0. So my Miller-Bravais notation for this extended plane, whose only base I have shown, in the green color line is 2, 1 bar, 1 bar, 0. What is my point? My point is, whenever the plane under interest lies outside the unit cell, you will end up with fractional numbers when you take reciprocal, and you have to convert them into the integer numbers by multiplying with the LCM. Okay, there is a query from Siddhant. His question is, how do I know the given plane is at 2 unit distance away or the magnitude is somewhat different? You can see it by yourself. I have taken 2 equal length of green color arrows. Can you see along the A2 axis the magnitude of the first green color arrow and the second green color arrow is at equal distance? That is why the magnitude along A2 was -2. Now, instead, if I draw another extension of this, let me show it with a yellow line. I am making one more extension. Let's say this is now along A2, the 3 unit distance. And now I draw a line which is passing from that particular point. Let's say a line lies like this. Then it will be at A3 distance away, right? So you have to take unit distance, and unit distance is always either 1 unit or 2 unit or 3 unit or 4 unit. So you have to see vis-a-vis to the center how much distance is being located vis-a-vis to the center. Is it clear? Siddhant, is it clear? Okay, good. Let's proceed further. So the point that you should remember is, if the plane lies outside your intercepts, when you convert into reciprocals will be a fractional number, and you have to clear the fractionals by multiplying with the LCMs. Okay, now we have 2 different unit cells, and this time the given planes are the ones which are not precisely vertically up plane, rather than it is resting vis-a-vis to the vertical axis, means it is inclined with a vertical axis. So your fourth index, which is the L index, now possess a non-zero value. Our process will be identical. First, we will look only in the basal plane and try to find out the intercept on A1, A2, and A3. So look at the first case, the triangular plane. Find out the intercept of that particular plane on the basal axis. So its intercept with A1 is at +1. Can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we were discussing the Miller-Bravais notation for the triangular plane. It intersects the A1 axis at +1. The A2 axis at +1, and vis-a-vis to A3 axis, the plane passes from -0.5. So my intercepts on A1, A2, A3 are 1, 1, -1.5. Generally, if it is a vertical plane, that is the plane running parallel to the L axis, you get the fourth index to be infinity. In this particular case, it is not the parallel to the L axis, rather than it is inclined to the L axis and it crosses the L axis at 1. Focus on this line of the plane where it intersects your L axis. It intersects your L axis at 1. So your fourth notation or fourth intercept will also be equal to 1. So here is the point. Whenever you have an inclined plane, your fourth value will be a non-zero value. So my intercepts are now 1, 1, bar, 1 half, and 1. You take the reciprocals and put them in the parentheses. So my HKIL or Brevis, Miller-Brevis notation is 1, 1, bar 2, 1 for the given triangular plane. Let us focus on the lower unit cell. There is another blue color plane. This plane is also an inclined plane vis-a-vis to the vertical axis. Can you see the inclination? Let me show it. This is the C-axis or the L-axis, and the plane is inclined with reference to that. So it is intersecting the L-axis or say C-axis. You have to find out now the intercept first in the basal plane. So let's do that. At A1 axis, the base of the plane crosses it at 1. So my first intercept is 1. Vis-a-vis to A2, focus here. This is the base of my plane under interest. And this is my A2 axis. What you can see is A2 axis and the base of the plane under interest run parallel. So my second axis is infinity. Third one, A3, the plane under interest intersects with the negative A3 axis at minus 1. So my third index will be minus 1. And the fourth one is the vertical one. It crosses at the upper edge, so it is plus 1. Now I have to take the reciprocals. So the Brevis Miller notation for the shaded plane will be 1, reciprocal of infinity will be 0, reciprocal of minus 1 is bar 1, and reciprocal of 1 will remain 1. So 1, 0, bar 1, 1 is the Miller Brevis notation for this particular given plane. Everybody got this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Now, I suggest you to practice more, because if you don't practice on this, you will not be able to attempt these problems. So my suggestion to you is practice, practice, and practice. Then only you will be able to attempt these particular questions. As I told you, both the direction and planes together will going to give you at least 10 marks problem. So your 10 marks question is now open to you. You have to practice the direction and plane in the unit cell. Book is the Raghavan's book. So most of the problems that we have discussed so far belongs to the Raghavan's book. Now we are moving to the next topic, which is linear and planar density. We people have been taught the concept of density in solid. How do you define the bulk density in solid? We used to define it as the ratio of mass to the volume. And from where the mass comes? The mass comes from the mass of the constituent atoms. So if I take the volume, which is a 3D version, and take the ratio of the total mass within that volume, I get the bulk density. What if my dimensions are not 3D? If I am looking along a particular direction, that is a 1D, or I am looking on a particular plane, which is a 2D, and try to see how dense the atoms are packed in that region. To define that, we have two different types of densities. They are called linear and planar density. As their name suggests, linear density represents the one-dimensional case, while the planar density represents the two-dimensional case. Or you can say the linear and planar densities are one-dimensional and two-dimensional analog of three-dimensional bulk density. Yani ki bulk density, if you want to convert into 1D, you end up with linear density. And if you want to convert the bulk density into 2D, you end up into a planar density. Why this is important? This is important because in crystallography, we always define every property in definite direction of the lattice or on a particular definite plane of the lattice. That is why we are intended to study the linear and the planar density. Look at this table. In this particular table, we have shown modulus of elasticity of different metals in three different directions. Now you remember the square bracket 100 or square bracket 110 or square bracket 111 means the direction. So if I measure the modulus of elasticity of aluminium in 100 direction, it is 63.7. In 110 direction, it is 72.6. And in 111 direction, it is 76.1. That means for the same material, which is aluminium, my modulus possesses different values in different crystallographic direction. Remember, 100 direction is along the edge of the unit cell, 110 direction is along the face diagonal, and 111 direction is along the body diagonal. So if I measure in three different directions, I get three different modulus of elasticity. The question is, why it is so? Why the same material in different direction possess different modulus of elasticity? Is it because in three different directions, the density of atoms are different? Answer is yes. Your density of metals in three different directions are different, and because of this, your modulus of elasticity is different. So how do I know what is the density of my crystal in one particular direction? To find that, we will going to define a quantity which is called the linear density. So we will work it out what is the linear density in different crystallographic direction. Since we are running out of time, I am not attempting the description of linear density in different crystallographic directions today. We will do it in the next class. So we are closing our today's discussion. If you have any questions or queries, please write them to me. I will be happy to answer them at a later stage. So we are closing our today's session.